Someone came to me. Well, first of all, we started at 9:30 and we ended at 12, 2.5 hours, 9:30 to 12, 2.5. And then we had a little tea break and then we had about 50 minutes for an answer, but still we could not complete the subject of riba. Even the half an hour that we now have still would not be enough. Someone came to me and said, I need to buy a house. It's a critical need for that. The house is on sale for 500,000 rands and I need another 200,000. I'm going to get it from the bank. What alternative is there for me? Because I desperately need the house, I have the children, I need. But first of all, you must in your heart have this firm resolve. I'd rather dig my grave and bury myself, but I don't want riba, not for me, not for my family, not for my children, no. And then you must raise your hands and make dua to Allah, who has already said, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا. Whosoever has fear of Allah, إِلَىٰ آخِرِ الْآيَةِ, He will open a way for you. If you have money and you do not want it to remain unused, don't put it in the bank in a fixed deposit so that the bank will invest it and the bank will give you a fixed return on your money so you get some income. No, you invest it yourself, you see? So this becomes a partnership that you will put up the 200,000 and that person will put up the 300,000. Or if you don't have 200,000, two people with 100,000 each, or four people with 50,000 each, will put up the balance and the house is bought. When the house is bought, you are not the sole owner. All those who have participated become partners in the ownership of the house. Good. So you have a 60% ownership, and that person who paid the 200 has a 40% ownership in the house. The partnership is responsible for paying taxes. The partnership is responsible for maintenance and repairs in the proportion of ownership. So if it's 1,000 rands to be paid for maintenance, you will pay 600 and your partner will pay 400 because you have a 60% ownership. It's called equity, 60% equity, 40%. Now, the partnership now signs an agreement with you, a rental agreement. And the rental agreement is based upon market rental value, which is determined independently. Suppose the market rental value is 5,000 rand a month, then you will pay. In order to occupy the house, you will pay 5,000 rands a month. When you do that, 3,000 will come back to you. So you're paying only 2,000. But the book shows that you paid 5, and then 3,000 came back to you because you have a 60% ownership in the house. And your partner will get 2,000 rands. This is halal for him. I have never found as yet, apart from one PhD thesis, one solid brick. Any attack on the validity of a rental agreement. So I am not that much of a scholar in this field to be able to critically determine the subject. But because I have not seen anything that is credible as an attack on a rental agreement that is invalid, I have come to the conclusion, as everybody else have come to the conclusion, that a rental agreement is permissible in Islam. Good. But the partnership will sign a second agreement, two agreements, independent agreements. You have two agreements in one. And the second agreement permits you to buy the ownership that your partner has in the house. Buy either in stages or whenever you are in a position to buy. So, you 1 year you'll buy 10% from his 40, so yours become 17, his is 30. But every time that you buy part of the ownership of the house or part of the equity, it must always be on the basis of the market value of the house, which can change, yes? It can go up, it can go down. Because in Islam, business transactions are always made in the market, meaning at market price. Eventually, you now own 80% of the house, and your partner owns 20%. So, when you pay you're still paying your 5,000 every month in rent, but now 4,000 comes back to you, and 1,000 goes to your partner. Until eventually, you buy out your partner, and you have 100% ownership of the house. You have paid less this way than if you had gone to the bank to borrow the 2,000, because you've cut out a third party. Number two, you have not entered into riba, except the part about the brands. If you can designate the transaction in dinars and work in dinars, you cut out that part of it. And number three, your partner has received a halal return on his investment. So here is a method in which you can buy houses, buy cars and so on without entering into riba. You just have to look for people who want to invest their money halal. I don't want to put the money in a fixed deposit. Any questions on this answer? But so you can continue. Very good, mashallah. You must not invite too many questions. People want to sleep. Number two. Those of you who heard the radio talk last night would have heard that the suspiciously docile conduct of the Egyptian armed forces in the face of the Egyptian uprising, dramatic Egyptian uprising. Never had something like that in Egyptian history. Not even in the case of the Jamal Abdel Nasser revolution. We are anticipating that suspicious, docile conduct has a story behind it. And the story behind it is that the next chapter would be that the Egyptian armed forces are going to hold elections in Egypt, that they're going to be very strange for Egyptians who are already so accustomed to by voting 99% in favor of Hosni Mubarak, and you know. But now this is going to be strange. This is going to be a rare election. Huh? And the Egyptian armed forces or the government will try to stack the table in favor of the Islamic movement. I'm not using any names, I'm just saying Islamic movement. And it is not far-fetched for us to anticipate that a couple of months down the road, the Islamic movement in Egypt could form the government. One of the reasons why the Egyptian people came out onto the streets so dramatically in such huge numbers, one of the reasons, is because of biting poverty. Biting poverty and destitution amongst the masses of Egypt. The overwhelming majority of whom could never afford to come to this retreat. So they would be looking forward with tears in their hearts that Islam will take them out of poverty. Islam will take them out of this biting misery because we now have Islam in government. When they become even poorer, when an Islamic government comes, that will set the stage for the slaughter of Islam. Lots of people will lose faith in Islam. Credibility will be gone. But why would an Islamic government in Egypt fail to take the people out of fighting poverty and destitution? Riba is the reason. Sheikh Mohammed Abdu, the Sheikh al-Azhar, 100-something years ago, the end of the last century, went to Europe. This is after the French Revolution had broken the back of the Christian Church, and the prohibition of riba, which had been enforced in Christian Europe. Just read that. You know the British Sheikh I talk about? What was his name? Shakespeare, yeah. What was the name of the book? Merchant of Venice. The back of the Christian Church was broken in Europe, and an economy had emerged now which was based on riba. The political system also, the back of the Christian Church was broken. Europe was Christendom. And as Christendom, Europe recognized Allah, meaning God, as Al-Malik. We call it divine right of kings, the theory, the political theory. And Al-Malik appointed the church as his representative, his Khalifa, church in Rome, the Pope. And the Pope had to anoint you as king or as emperor. Otherwise, you would have no legitimacy in the eyes of the people. So there was this divine component which recognized Allah's sovereignty. The French Revolution destroyed that. And a new political system emerged in Europe in which Allah is no longer sovereign, the state is now sovereign. Parliament is sovereign, Supreme Court is sovereign. Allah can make a law to prohibit riba. We, the state, can make it halal. Both the economic part and the political were shirk. Shirk. The very foundation was shirk. But Sheikh al-Azhar forgot to take his torchlight with him when he went to Europe. So he couldn't see the shirk. So he came back to Egypt and made a statement which Sheikh al-Azhar said, I went to Egypt and I found Islam, but I did not find Muslims.
Europe.
So I went to Europe. And I found Islam, but I did not find Muslims. And I've come back to Egypt where I find Muslims, but I do not find Islam. Meaning he was utterly and totally and completely deceived by Europe. He then went on to issue his infamous fatwa. The British who were in India, in Egypt, controlling Egypt really, the figurehead, Egyptian government was at the figurehead, the British decided to establish an efficient postal system. So the Egyptian post office was established. And they decided that the Egyptian post office must be funded through public funding. People would invest in a commercial enterprise called the post office. And this is something that the Egyptian people can see. It is very beneficial that you can mail parcels and mail letters and so on to the post office. But they said that when you invest your money in the post office, you're going to get a fixed return on your investment. And Sheikh Al-Azhar gave the fatwa that this is not riba. A fixed return is riba because it is not business. In order for it to qualify as business, you must embrace risk. You can make a profit or you can suffer a loss. That is business. But here is a fixed return. Come rain or come sunshine, you're getting your return on your investment. And so this is not business, this is riba. Egypt, to this day, is still imprisoned by that fatwa. The second part of the equation is that not only has Al-Azhar University been imprisoned by this fatwa, and Al-Azhar up to today is insisting that bank interest is not riba, but the second part about it is up to this day Al-Azhar has not recognized the modern monetary system of paper money, non-redeemable paper money, to be bogus, to be fraudulent, to be haram. And so there is no way that an Islamic government in Egypt, in this context, can escape an attack by the enemy to make the Egyptian people even poorer than they are now. When I arrived in Egypt in 1963, you were not born as yet, no? In 1963, one Egyptian pound, how much was it, I think? It was about 1.5 US dollars, I think, £1. And the sterling pound was about 3 Egyptian pounds to 1 sterling pound, would you know that? Anyhow, so you're getting a salary, you work for the whole month, and you get a salary in Egyptian pounds, in paper, of course. And with your salary for a whole month, you can buy a camel. But then something strange happened to the Egyptian pound after a few years, and now the same amount of work and the same salary you're getting, you can't buy a camel anymore, you can only buy a donkey. Huh? And then a couple of years later, Zimbabwe is laughing, eh? You can't buy a donkey anymore. You can only buy a goat. And then a couple of years later, The same salary, same work, you can't buy a goat anymore, you can only buy a chicken. It's called inflation. Inflation. And the normal way of understanding inflation is that the prices are going up. No, you dumb dumb. It's not the prices going up, it's the money going down. This bogus and fraudulent monetary system has within it an inbuilt mechanism to rip you off every time the value of the money falls. There is a massive transfer of wealth that takes place from the unsuspecting masses to a predatory, let me use a terminology, that's one of you reminded me, the blood-sucking predatory elite, which is both in the domestic economy and in the international economy. And so the monetary system that we now have is a system which is haram based on this verse of the Quran, which is repeated three times in the Quran. Wala, 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 wala tabkhasu an-nasa ashiya'ahum. Inflation. Suppose your grandfather died and he left you some money. This is your part of the inheritance. But you were a baby. He left you 100 dinars, gold dinars. But you were a baby, so your guardians had to put it away. So they put it in a box and they locked it. And 25 years later, you are grown up and you are sufficiently mature, and they feel you should get your money. So they opened the box and they took it out, and they gave you the 100 dinars. MashaAllah, the gold dinar had faithfully preserved what your father had left for you. Faithfully preserve the value of what your father had left for you. It has done that all through history. And they knew that. So what they did, Dajjal, in order to rule the world, not just to rip you off, it's more than that, in order to be able to eventually rule the world, was they took the 100 dinars out of the box and they put in paper. And they said, maybe this grandchild would love the US dollar because it is written there on the US dollar, in God we trust. Have you seen it? Take a look at it. In God we trust. So, mashallah, this is really the best of all money, isn't it? So, with 100 ounces of gold, they got $3,500 at $35 an ounce, and the Bretton Woods, right? So, they took the $3,500 and put it in the box, and they locked it up. 25 years later, when you were a young man and sufficiently mature, they said you should get your money. So they opened the box and they took out the $3,500 and they gave it to you. But you rubbed your eyes and you said, ah, excuse me, is this what my grandpa left for me? They said, no, grandpa left for you 100 dinars. And he then said, give me my 100 dinars, please, or that, report to the police. So they had to go very quickly to the market to change the US dollars back into dinars. and then they came and they gave you 8 dinar. 8 dinar. 92% of the money was lost, gone, because of inflation. I know of one man who would not take this sitting down. This man would ask, where did my money go? Who took my money? That's why they killed him, Malcolm X. Who took my money? Where did my money go? It didn't evaporate in the clouds. And in the pursuit of those questions to seek the answers, he would have discovered that his loss was their gain. And this is what Allah speaks of in Surah An-Nisa. وَأَخْزِهِمُ الرِّبَى وَقَدْ نُهُوا عَنْهُ. What did he say, Allah? وَأَخْزِهِمُ الرِّبَى وَقَدْ نُهُوا عَنْهُ. Oh, it was haram for them. Allah made it haram for them. If they listen to this lecture, they would know I'm speaking the truth. In the Torah, it was haram for them. Nabi Isa alayhi salam made it haram for them. Riba. But when we go to the Torah, we find something else. That the Torah now says, it is haram for an Israelite to lend on interest to another Israelite. But it is halal for him to lend on interest to those who are not Israelites, the Ummiyun, translated as Gentiles, but otherwise known as cockroaches. So they changed the word of Allah in order to be able to become money lenders to the world. وَأَخْزِهِمُ الرِّبَى وَقَدْلُهُ عَنْهُ وَأَكْلِهِمْ أَمْوَالَ النَّاسِ بِالْغَاطِرِ. And in the process, they were consuming the wealth of mankind unjustly, because my loss was your gain. That's not business. And so inflation all around the world today has its roots in riba, a fraudulent, bogus and fraudulent and haram monetary system. What is coming now, the new money that I call electronic and one of you called digital, you know, because you got a new camera. Digital. The new money which is coming to replace the paper money is coming not just to rip you off. Imagine, I have a bank account and all I need to do is, once I control the system, just type in on my computer. I get $1 million in my account. Abracadabra. And this sheikh out here, he's supporting the Palestinians. So I look and I see how much money he has. He can't stop me because the money is in the bank. And all the records are there. So I went and I typed something and his account is frozen. You know the word? Frozen. Who is he going to complain to? He lost his money. Can't get it. This is tomorrow. They can type in as much money as they want and type out as much money as they want. And once you are within their money system of the world, you are a slave to them. And so what is before us is not just exploitation, economic and monetary exploitation. It is slavery which is ahead of us, so that they can rule the world. So long as you are using that monetary system, you are on board the ship. So if the city is comfortable for you, the trains run on time, you know, the supermarkets are so very nicely organized, you just go on the shelves and pick up what you want and go to the cashier and pass it through a machine and all the prices just come onto the screen. Have you seen it? Huh? My gosh, this city is like heaven. So if you want to live in heaven, remember you're on board the ship. If you want to get off this ship, however, Allah is testing you. It's not going to be easy to get off the ship. A man will have to flee to the mountain sides where rain falls and take with him some sheep and goats in order to protect and preserve faith. There are no toilets inside the house on the mountain side. And so the subject of the prohibition of riba has now assumed even more critical importance for us. Any questions before we go back to sleep? All right, I think we will call it a day over there. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.